moved away from there about a week after I was born. My mother had to drive us all the way across the country to Pensacola, Florida. Well, my mother didn't want to live alone with a baby in a brand new town.
Sure.
So she went to Pensacola, Florida, which is where all his sisters lived, his sisters and his mother.
Were your artistic pursuits supported by your family?
Yes. I built toys.
What kind of toys did you build?
Stiff paper and thin wood, and made masks and painted faces. Well, I was drawing and painting from the time I was like 3 years old. Mm-hmm. And my mother painted, and my grandmother painted. My grandmother and I at one time took lessons in drawing and painting in Pensacola. I think I was about 5 and she was about 80. My mother and my sister sang, and my mother was a piano player. She played at parties and things her whole life.
Yvonne and her mother ended up traveling around the world following her father, who was a dentist for the Navy. Ed retired from the Navy and opened a private dental office in Pensacola. Shortly after that, he and Joe were divorced. Yvonne would work part-time in her father's office throughout her childhood, at one time even drilling a filling when her father was out of the office. Yvonne was popular in school and a member of the Honor Society. Yvonne ended up in the marching band and played several instruments. She received a scholarship to Louisiana State University and planned on becoming a high school band teacher. But the pressures of the music program were very intense and she struggled to keep up. She discovered a love of painting with instructor Peter Kahn and others. So she switched majors. Her father didn't think a painting major was practical, so he stopped supporting her financially. But with the help of her teachers, she graduated anyway. Yvonne and her roommate, Betty King, the sweetheart of Sigma Alpha Epsilon, decided to go to Provincetown to study with renowned painting teacher Hans Hoffman. They arrived broke, but Hans took a liking to the young artists and helped get them jobs and a place to stay. Betty started dating Dominic Falcone, Val, a dishwasher where Betty was a hostess. Val was an intense young man fresh out of the Navy with a degree in business administration from Bryan College. He was interested in poetry and acting. He became fascinated with Yvonne and tried to date her, but she thought he was weird and said no. But he persisted, and eventually they hit it off.
What was the inspiration for opening the Sun Gallery?
Let's see. My husband Val and I met in Provincetown. And the next year when we came back, we knew what we wanted to do. We drove by a friend's place where I had shown my paintings before, and he was gone. So we went immediately to the landlady and rented the place for the summer, and that was the Sun Gallery.
I guess there was a lot of art galleries in Provincetown even then, in the 50s, right?
Oh, yeah, there were a lot of art galleries. I thought we could do better.
what did you think was missing from the other art galleries?
Art.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, art galleries in town were set up mostly to sell. And what I wanted to do was show people who did really good work. And if they sold, it was good.
How did you start to collaborate with Red Grooms?
I was running the Sun Gallery in Provincetown, and my husband, and I was also supporting him. In the morning, I'd sell art supplies at the studio shop. In the afternoon, I'd run the gallery. And in the afternoon and night, my husband would go wash dishes at a restaurant the other end of town. Can't think of the name right there.
Is it the Moors?
Yes. And one evening, a couple of young boys came in and wanted a job. So Red was his assistant.
Assistant dishwasher?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And they became friends?
Yes.
And
we had the gallery going then.
And did he show you his artwork?
Yes, Red showed me his artwork, and it was the first year we had the gallery going. It was about halfway through the summer, and I looked at it and I said, I think we can give you a one-man show.
That was big for him. He was like 19 years old at the time, right?
18 or 19.
That's a big step for a teenager.
What did I care? I like good stuff.
You liked his artwork right away.
Oh, yeah.
Red, Yvonne, and Val would become close friends and collaborators for many years, even sharing an illegal loft in New York City one winter. In 1959, Red would lead the first happening at the Sun Gallery, with other local artists, including Yvonne, as part of the performance. The show was a big hit and played many times.
Well, when did you decide to close it?
We had the gallery for 5 years, but in the middle of the fourth year, unexpectedly, I became pregnant with a baby boy. And we had him the fifth summer, but it was, you know, very hard to run a gallery and have a baby at the same time.
Yvonne was experimenting with filmmaking and teaching a children's art class out of her house.
I had a children's art class. That's where it came from. Children's art class. And I think one of the students said, I showed a couple of my movies that the kids in my children's art class. And they said, Yvonne, let's us make films too. So I said, okay.
The Elbaugh Workshop's first short was made using papier-mâché characters and plastic army men. Yvonne directed a group of children based on a script by 12-year-old Steve Dottori. The Elbaugh Cache, their second film, was a collection of shorts made by children ages 6 through 14 and included everything from nursery rhymes to giant sea monsters.
And I started distributing the films.
And winning
all over the country
and entering in film festivals.
Yeah. I guess we had our films were shown nationwide on a couple of television programs.
Yeah, but I remember the story you told me where it was shown at Harvard at a big film showing there, and it was very popular.
Yeah, we had several showings at Harvard.
And that would be early on in your career.
We did have a show at Harvard.
And it was very popular.
Yeah. Father John Culkin got us a lot of jobs, and I was able to send my assistants around the United States to various places.
A news company wanted to do a documentary on the Yellow Ball Workshop.
Oh, yeah.
And they lent you a camera and sound equipment for you and Dad to do footage of the kids.
Oh, what they did was, I think it was NBC, they came with a full crew, and then they realized that when I was having class, that making animated films takes a long time. So they didn't want to have to send a crew all the way from New York every weekend. So they must have given us a camera or something.
Almost every year you would try something new with the classes.
Oh yeah, because the same people came. And of course I wanted to try out new stuff every year and see how it worked.
People returning year after year.
Oh yeah.
And some of them would turn into your assistants. You want to talk about that a little bit?
Yes.
Could you tell right away this person is really into this?
Oh yeah, because in my classes I wanted them not only to do the artwork and the story, but to help run the camera and to set up the lights and all of that stuff, and then to edit it. So everyone was supposed to be able to do everything.
When I was 17, I had the great good fortune of enrolling in a animated film class for the summer at a place called the Newton Creative Arts Center. And up until that time in my life, I hadn't found my passion. And studying with Yvonne in this class that summer really gave me, I don't know, it gave me an identity. It gave me a thing. Things were very happening back then. You wanted to have your thing. You wanted to do your thing. So Yvonne really helped me to realize that dream. She was probably around 30 at the time, maybe 35, and I admired her. She was very, very supportive. She was very amused by her students, and she made that clear to us all. She was very matter-of-fact, but at the same time, you just felt her support all the time. You felt her support. And it was a beautiful thing to be bathed in, to be bathed in the light of Yvonne's support and kindness and creativity. And she really changed my life. She literally, you know, set it on a totally different path. And for that, I will ever be grateful. So thank you, Yvonne. Great job. Great job doing your thing.
The thing which was extraordinary about working with Yvonne is the trust she had in us, the faith she had in our ability to carry out projects and to do the very best we could. It was an extraordinary opportunity to work with somebody who was absolutely sure that we could all do great things. It was more than that, because I feel like the way I'm saying it, it's based on the idea that it was a spoken idea. It was the way Yvonne was. It was that we were all completely capable of doing wonderful, wonderful things. And so it just, the whole atmosphere radiated that. There was also the sense of collaboration as we were going forward, working on our own films that would end up being on one reel. So we helped each other with the animation. My remembrance is we didn't often film scenes by ourselves. The person whose film it was might be doing the animation, but somebody else was taking the images. When it came time to do editing, there were other people contributed by their opinions. We looked at each other's rushes together. People collaborated on soundtracks. I didn't collaborate on soundtracks, but you know, other people helped me with theirs. And some of my most fond memories were hearing people, particularly Jeannie, working on soundtracks on people's films. People were drawn in to help each other.
Hi, I'm Amy Marish. I was Amy Berkovitz when I joined Yellow Ball Workshop in the 1970s, and I may have been the only assistant who didn't begin as a student at Yellow Ball Workshop, and therefore I didn't know anything, and Yvonne trained me to do everything that they did at the workshop. And very kindly, very generous, she would say to me, do you know how to load a Bolex 16mm film camera? And I would say, yeah, which was a lie. And she would say, okay, well, let me show you how we load it. And she trained me that way. And I consider her a lifelong mentor, because she did exactly what she wanted to, and harnessed and developed the immense spontaneity and creativity of so many children. And when she was discouraged from entering reels of Yellow Ball Workshop in competition, she said, "My animators are artists. They're just short." I love that she said that.
Okay, so Paul has asked me to tell a story about Yvonne, and the story I think I'd like to tell is maybe one of the most important stories to me. And that is when I was 11 years old. It was 1967 at the Newton Creative Arts Center. And I took my very first animation class with Yvonne, and she taught us how to do cutout animation. So she gave us the materials. I went home and I did all my homework. We were supposed to prepare a cutout face and a cutout long shot, and I worked really hard on it, and I made everything in a million pieces. And Yvonne had told us that you just take a photograph every time it moved, and I thought, I don't like taking photographs. So I came back the next day and I said, I don't think I want to do animation, you have to take photographs. And she said, do you know what taking a photograph is? It's just going. And she said, why don't you shoot that scene? So I thought, okay, so I shot it. And of course it came back and it absolutely changed the entire course of my life. And if she hadn't said that one thing, why don't you shoot it? You've already done all the work. My whole life would have been different. And that's how insightful a teacher Yvonne was and is.
As Yvonne's son, I became one of her first students. And later on, at around the age of 14, I became a TA for her. I remember we were doing a class with other teachers as the students. And she was, that day we were doing storyboards. All the students were supposed to make very short films, about under a minute long, and the storyboards should reflect that. And I was going over each of the storyboards of each of the students, and I noticed one woman had written a very long story based on something that had really happened to her. With her son. She tried to go to the beach with her son, and she was not able to get to the actual beach because of private property in between it, and it had made a big impact on her, and she wanted to tell that story. Well, looking at the story, but I realized it would take like at least 5 minutes to do the story that she had written. So I took her storyboard, and I started making X's through it, and till I cut it down till I thought she could fit into a 1 minute film. And I walked away feeling very pleased with myself. Anyway, the woman went to Yvonne and said, this guy just wrecked my story. I want to do it the way I originally wrote it. And Yvonne told her, fine, let her do that. And when I heard this, I said, Yvonne, you can't, we can't possibly, she can't possibly make this movie. It's way too long. And she said she has to just discover that for herself. You have to let her do that. And sure enough, later that same day, she realized that she couldn't possibly make the film in the the way that she originally wrote it. And she ended up making her own modifications to make it shorter. Yvonne taught me you cannot teach people something that they are not ready to learn. And you should have compassion for those people and let them learn on their own.
Yvonne had a huge impact on me as a student, and I try to model my teaching on hers. One thing I'll never forget is one day I was a starving student, so I hadn't eaten very much, and I don't know how Yvonne knew it, but she had asked me if I had eaten that day, and I said no. So she brought me up to her office, and she gave me granola bars and milk, and I was so grateful, and that had such a huge impact on me. And so ever since then, I always made sure I had granola bars available for my students, because I wanted to do the same thing for them that she did for me. And she impacted me in so many different ways, like the way she is so organized and fair and such a great communicator. All of those things I try to emulate in my own teaching as well.
I was a Brown student in Rhode Island, interested in filmmaking, but I had taken the one filmmaking class that Brown offered, so I was sort of out of luck. And then a friend of mine, a studio art major at Brown, said, you know, we can take classes at RISD and get credit for it at Brown. So we went down College Hill, where RISD is, and tried to register for animation classes. And because we were Brown students, we were sort of lowest priority. So we got closed out of the animation classes, but we managed to get into a class called optical printing. And that's where I first met Yvonne. And I distinctly remember addressing her as Professor Andersen and her saying to me, just call me Yvonne, everybody does. And that's one of the things that when you get to know Yvonne, you know she's the most down-to-earth person you could ever possibly meet. She's always looking out for the benefit of others. She's the most organized person you'll ever meet. And, you know, she just was a great mentor to me, because not only did she teach me optical printing and animation, but because I worked as a teaching assistant, she basically taught me how to teach. And I happened to be in the fortuitous position of, after graduating from RISD and I was sticking around Providence for a little while, an opening came. They were trying actually to get Yvonne to teach another section of her beginning animation class. And I think she was already teaching something like 7 or 8 classes. So she gave me my first opportunity by basically saying, David, you can teach this. And that was my first teaching gig. So I'll always be indebted to Yvonne for a lot of things. But chiefly, I think it's just for getting to know her and the fact that she always treated everybody like a peer and not like a student.
So what I would like to mention about Yvonne was how she sort of pushed me and got me to do things I normally never would have done. I ended up getting a gig through the school because they were teaming up with a ad agency. They wanted to do a commercial for their continuing education program, and Yvonne encouraged me to go after it, and I did, and I got the job. And so I had my work televised while I was still a student. I think I was a junior at the time. Anyway, I did this claymation in my apartment, and Yvonne gave me the Bolex and some gaffer tape and a tripod, and I remember she was just as nervous as I was, waiting for the footage, and it was almost like it was her movie, because we were both so relieved, like it came out, because it was all stop motion. I remember her just being really proud of me that I pulled that off, and I just remember feeling so good about that, and that was just something I didn't get at home. I left my Hollywood animation career after 16 years in the business, and I set out to pursue my other interest in children's books, and I became a published children's book author and illustrator. And I still hope to continue to do that, and it's my dream to have one of my books made into an animated film someday. And if and when that happens, well, Yvonne Andersen, you were very instrumental in my early development as an artist, and you'll take credit in that too. So thank you so much, Yvonne, for all you did for me and for others. And I feel much gratitude towards you and much love.
As I look back on that experience, I'd have to say that Yvonne was my absolute favorite teacher. She had an approach to her teaching that was very simple and incredibly effective. My last project that I did with her was at the end of the school year, and it was very ambitious, and she didn't say I couldn't do it. She said, go for it, knowing that maybe I wouldn't finish it, and I didn't in the school year, so that didn't discourage her from saying to keep going with it. And she went one step further and invited me up to her studio in Lexington. And with the help of her son, Paul, I spent a few weeks working on the end of this film. And it was incredibly satisfying. With that said, that particular project went on to receive national recognition and at the Student Academy Awards. And I have to say that that wouldn't have happened without her flexibility and passion for her work. So I can only say thank you for the opportunity to say this on record. And as always, I will be very appreciative of the time spent with you.
Yvonne Andersen was one of the best teachers I ever had. She was just so devoted, so dedicated to teaching animation. You know, I was working on a film called Wham Bam Thank You Clam. It was my, this was in the spring semester. We were doing stop motion clay animation in our class. And I came in with a storyboard for Wham Bam Thank You Clam. And she really loved it. It was about a family at the beach, but she didn't like the ending. She said, you know, Willie, I think you need to go home and come in, think about it some more. I think you can come up with a better idea for an ending. Come up with something funnier and more unexpected. So then I went home and I just racked my brain. I came up with this other ending. And she laughed and she said, that's the ending. That's the ending. That's great. That's funny. Anyway, I have nothing but fond memories of being in her classes. You just look forward to that day of the week, and you enjoyed every minute you were in that class.
I started RISD as a painting major and enjoyed it, but there was something missing. And I took a winter session class that Yvonne taught, the animation winter session class, and I had fun. And that was the missing piece. I really enjoyed myself. And a lot of that had to do with Yvonne's teaching method. She was a very supportive, very nurturing teacher. She didn't talk down to the students. She talked kind of straight ahead.
So the first time I met Yvonne Andersen was in the 80s when I was at Rhode Island School of Design, and I was lucky enough to take a winter session course in animation, which she was teaching. I was thrilled to get into the course. It was hard to get into all of her courses. They were very popular, but I was able to slip in into the winter session course. It was then that I fell in love with film and animation, and especially Yvonne. I think probably my favorite memory of Yvonne was actually born of rejection. I wasn't able to continue in taking another course with her because I was an illustration major, and because the competition was pretty fierce to get into her classes, they gave first dibs to film and video majors. So that left me out, and I was disappointed, but it was that disappointment didn't last long because Yvonne took me aside. She put her arm around me and she said, you know, I'm very disappointed that you can't be in my class. And she went on to tell me very encouraging things about my work and made me feel like $1 million and really kind of turned the tables and made me feel like she was the one that was missing out on having me in her class. Just somebody who had only played with animation once, although we played pretty hard in her classes. But I ended up walking away from that experience thinking that I had something special with her and that she saw something special in me. And I still think of that all the time. Whenever I have a little bit of success at something, I definitely go back to my favorite teacher from RISD, and that would definitely be Yvonne.
My introduction to Yvonne was during freshman year at the Rhode Island School of Design, where one winter session I took an animation class. And during my first few classes with her, being a college freshman, it was a very overwhelming and terrifying experience. And she seemed very serious all the time. So I wasn't sure if I was going to like her. But periodically, something would amuse her, and, you know, behind that tough exterior, serious shell, she seemed like a softy inside, and I adored her very quickly. I adored her. It takes a special kind of person to want to share that knowledge with others, and she does that so well.
Because it's hard to encapsulate anyone's life in 30 minutes, here are a few fun facts. Yvonne and her sister Carol were rescued out of a burning house by their maid Luella. She got a raise. When Yvonne was around 10 years old, working at her father's dental office, she absconded with a bunch of teeth and made a necklace out of it. Yvonne, Red Grooms, and Lester Johnson created a giant outdoor art project. 3 billboard-sized paintings that confused many patrons. What's it advertising, they would ask?
When we were growing up, we had a lot of filmmakers come to the house, and they would babysit for us sometimes. And I think we were about, I was about 5, my brother was about 7, somewhere around there, right around there. And the Couture brothers came to babysit, and they brought their twin girlfriends that were 300 pounds. The Couture brothers looked like the guys from Mad Magazine. I told my mother that they were bad boys and to send them away.
When I was going to RISD myself, I discovered the students had a nickname for Yvonne. It was Professor Mom. Our parents continue making movies with Red Grooms and his wife, Mimi Gross. Red wrote and directed Fat Feet, while Yvonne was the DP and the editor. Also, Red, Mimi, and both my parents and me and Jeannie also played parts in the film. Yvonne wrote several books as well as columns for film magazines. Yvonne played the baritone horn in the Lexington Town Band for many years. Yvonne and her mostly female proteges traveled all over the world, teaching animation workshops, judging at film festivals, and lecturing. Our parents never actually got married, although they told everyone they did. Val did ask Yvonne, but she turned him down, maybe influenced by the 7 failed marriages of her father. Despite the lack of a certificate, our parents stayed together until Val passed away in his sleep in his own bed in 2009. Yvonne never talked about feminism, empowerment, or equality, but she embodied it in how she treated people and led her life. She loved art, filmmaking, and teaching. And she spent her whole life doing what she loved.